I'm not getting nothing to pimp me. I believe what I speak. And if you need proof, just keep watching.
Final series of the year of 2015, this series entitled Christ Must. It's time to take Jesus off the bench. Christ Must. It's time to take Jesus off the bench. As I began this series, the Lord put it in my spirit to remind me before I had a wife, before I had a staff, before I had a deacon or even a member, I had a Bible. And I want you to repeat with me, if you will. We will do this every Sunday, close out 2015, to make sure we're right in the right place at the right time. Say this with me, if you will, and remain standing throughout the reading of God's word. But let's make this confession together. This is my Bible.
This is my Bible.
And today
I declare
it to be
my final authority.
I am who it says I am, and I can do
what it says
I can do. Now turn your Bibles to the book of John, chapter 1, verse 1. While you're standing, turn your Bibles to the book of John, chapter 1, verse 1. If the person standing next to you don't have a Bible or a smartphone to look up the word, share your word with them. We'll be reading from John 1 and 1 all the way down to verse number 8. And if you are strong enough, remain standing to the conclusion of God's word at verse number 8. I pray the anointing of God will fall fresh on me now.
Jesus' name.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Now I want you to go back and insert something. In the beginning was Jesus. And Jesus was with God. And Jesus was God. Jesus was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life. And that life was the light of all mankind. In him was light, and that light was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Still has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning the light being Jesus, so that through him, through Jesus, all might believe. He himself was not the light. John says, I'm not the light, but I came only as a witness to the light. Christ must, taking Jesus off the bench. Take your seats and let's have a conversation for the next 30 somewhat minutes. Let's have a conversation. Jesus is the light that overcomes the darkness. Let me say it again. Jesus is the light that overcomes the darkness. Today, if we are honest with one another, it appears the darkness is winning. If you really dissect what's going on with today's culture and today's society, it looks like, somebody say, looks like. It looks like darkness is winning because we have put Jesus, the light, on the bench. Today, I'm declaring the Greenhouse International Church will not continue to keep Jesus on the bench. And I'm also challenging all believers to get Jesus off the bench so Morris, we can win again. John here gives great insight when John declares, I am not the light, but only a witness to the light. We have too many people in the 21st century church that's trying to compete with Jesus. We are not the light. We're simply messengers of the light. We're simply carriers of the light. Don't get so high and mighty within yourself thinking the church can't go without you, thinking the church can't operate without you. We are not the source of the church. We're just carriers and workers and servants in the church. But unfortunately, the light has shined so bright on some of us, we have miscommunicated within ourselves, thinking that we have become the light. But John says here, I am not the light. See, the church has made a major mistake by turning the witness of the light, the messenger of the light, and the carrier of the light into the light. We now glorify one another. We no longer even call the name Jesus out.
Come on, man of God.
We will call one another name out over and over again, and then we will get upset and aggravated if somebody don't call our name during a worship service. Well, the worship service should be about lifting up Jesus. In our room carrying a flashlight or a candle, I don't become bigger than the light. I'm simply a light carrier. Yeah. We lose our true power when we put Jesus on the bench. Any sports fans in the house? It would not make sense for the best player on your team to ride the bench. Well, watch this. This week, there was another mass shooting in California. And the New York Daily News wrote these headlines. God isn't going to fix this. Let me say it again. Big bold letters, they put isn't going to fix this. And believe it or not, the shooting took place at a Christmas celebration. What should have been a time of celebration became a time of tragedy. How many of us have experienced that? Well, we were like Job's children. We were having a celebration for tragedy to break out. You woke up thinking today was going to be a good day. Today is going to be an Ice Cube type day. Today, none of my homies going to die today. Yet you experienced tragedy. God isn't going to fix this. But the Bible I read, the Bible I believe, clearly states there is, it doesn't say was, there is nothing too hard for God. Is that in your Bible? Have you ever heard that? That there's nothing too hard for God? But this is where the problem, the dilemma comes in. The church has kept Jesus on the bench so long, we've forgotten about Jesus' winning record. So I don't blame the editor of the New York Daily News. Because when Jesus established the church, he said, the gates of hell shall not prevail. And for some odd reason, we've taken the greatest weapon exposable to the church, accessible to the church. We put the greatest weapon on the bench. Why in the world will we turn away from Jesus? When he said, the church that I will build, the church that I will establish, the church that I will found, the gates of hell shall not prevail. Yet it looks like we're losing, and we're losing, Chandler, because we got Jesus riding the bench. The light, Jesus, shines in the darkness. And the darkness has not overcome it. Notice the text does not say past tense, but current tense. Jesus is the light. Let me get somebody to talk to the preacher. Say, Jesus is the light. The darkness has not, will not, and shall not defeat. The light. So why will we shut down a winning formula. Why would you have Michael Jordan on your team in the 80s and the 90s and not put him in the game when the clock run it down? No coach would make that decision, yet the church daily makes a decision to keep Jesus on the bench.
Watch this.
Because I want to touch every generation. Billboard magazine recently released the list of top 10 rappers of all time. This list, right, created a great deal of controversy. Because this list did not include Reverend Tupac. The hip-hop community became outraged, Darren, because they said, how can you have a greatest of all time list of rappers? How can you celebrate the history of rap music and not include Apostle Tupac? How can you, with any type of character and integrity, have a list talking about the rap culture and not include Dr. Tupac? So the hip-hop community rose up against the Billboard list. Yet the church sits quietly while we celebrate Christmas without celebrating Jesus Christ. The hip-hop community have enough sense to realize you can't have rap without Tupac, but the church is having Christmas without Christ. I know I have what's called a sports orientated congregation, so I know I have a lot of great football fans in the house. If you love football, holler back at me. Okay, watch this. How many ever heard of this guy called Tony Romo? He's a quarterback of the Dallas Cowboys. And how many of you, if you were put in position as a head coach and you had on your roster, on your team, you had Tony Romo, the quarterback of the Dallas Cowboys, but you also had on your team this cat called Tom Brady. Tom Brady, Super Bowl winning Tom Brady, NFL MVP Tom Brady, and you had Tom Brady on your roster, Tony Romo on your roster. How many of you in your right mind, unless you are a crazy diehard Cowboy fan, would pick Tony Romo over Tom Brady? And that coach who would do that would quickly get fired, because that wouldn't be a wise decision. If you got Tom Brady on your roster, Darren, you got to put him in the game. If you got Tom Brady, Super Bowl winning MVP, fourth quarter comeback kid, pretty boy Tom Brady the cover GQ magazine, Tom Brady first ballot Hall of Fame as soon as he retired, Tom Brady all that and a bag of chips, and you gonna pick Tony Romo to be your quarterback over Tom Brady? They gonna ask you, GM, what you smoking? Well, God is probably asking the church of the 21st century, what you smoking? You gonna pick Santa Claus over Jesus Christ? What kind of pills you popping? I can pass by and see Santa Claus, but can't hear Jesus Christ? What you want? The enemy has been trying to silence Jesus from day one, because the enemy recognized the potential of Jesus even before Jesus started turning water into wine. Church, not only does the enemy see the power of Jesus, but the enemy, get this now, this ought to make you shout right here. The enemy not just sees the power of Jesus, but the enemy understands when we connect with Jesus, when we believe in Jesus, and we live like Jesus, we become the most powerful force on the planet. That's why the enemy is aggressively trying to disconnect us from the Jesus factor. When we hook up with Jesus and yoke up with Jesus and line up with Jesus, there's no more powerful force on the planet Earth than a real believer. I can do all. Oh, that makes the devil tremble at night. I can do all. My Bible says I'm more than a conqueror. My Bible says, yea, though I walk through the shadow of the valley of death, I will fear no evil. My Bible says I am righteous. My Bible says, knock and it shall be given. My Bible says,
future shall prosper. My Bible says. So the devil will get me out of my Bible.
Because
if I stay in my Bible,
yeah.
I win.
Yeah, that's it. My God, this is good.
So the devil, the enemy,
come on,
wants to stop me
yeah, Lord.
From getting connected and plugged in with Jesus. The devil wants me tripping on happy holidays.
Yeah. Come on, man of God.
Red nosed reindeers. Christmas trees and lights.
Come on, man of God.
Ooh. Mistletoes.
Come on.
Eggnog.
Yeah.
Christmas parties.
Yeah. Jesus. Jesus.
So I won't be connected to Jesus.
Come on. Put him back in the game.
Turn your Bibles to Luke chapter 1. I gotta show you this. Turn your Bibles to Luke chapter 1. I'm having too much fun. Luke chapter 1, look at verse number 18. Watch it. I'm going to show you how the devil was afraid of Jesus even before Jesus got here, because he knew once Jesus got here, there would be a remnant of people that would actually start becoming disciples of Jesus, and he would have no power nor control over them. Because when you become a disciple of Jesus, you got the power to put your foot on the devil's head. I wish I had some real believers in here. You got the power to put your foot on the devil's head. You got the power to call a thing into existence. You got the power, as the Bible says, to be another speaking spirit. When you really believe the word of God, and when you really get hooked up with Jesus, that's nothing too hard.
Try
to sabotage your relationship with Jesus. Watch this. Luke chapter 1 verse 18. Zechariah asked the angel, how can I be sure of this? I am an old man and my wife is well along in years. The angel says to him, I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God and I have been sent to speak to you and to tell you this good news. And now you will be silent and not able to speak until the day this happens, because you did not believe my words, which will come true at the appointed time. Let me give you the backdrop real quick. God had an assignment for Zechariah and his wife Elizabeth to bring John into the world, because God had a purpose for John's life. But Zechariah, the father of John, was filled with doubt. So the angel of God had to silence him. See, sometimes God gotta shut you up, because if you keep talking, you're gonna talk yourself out of your next miracle. You're gonna talk yourself out of your next blessing, because you're gonna start saying stuff like, ain't nobody in my family ever did that. Ain't nobody in my family ever got a doctor's degree. Ain't nobody in my family ever got a master's. Ain't nobody in my family ever been debt free. Ain't nobody in my family ever got married and stayed married. Ain't nobody in my family ever had money in the bank. Ain't nobody in my family ever died and left a legacy for their children's children. Ain't nobody in my family ever been drug free. Ain't nobody in my family ever been drama free. Ain't nobody in my family ever really been in a right mind. You start talking yourself out of the promise of God. You stop talking yourself out of generational wealth. You start talking yourself out of the glory from glory. You start convincing yourself that it'll never get better than it is right now. So every now and then, God gotta shut you up so you won't talk you out of God's blessing. The enemy will use doubt and fear to stop you from believing, and there's another level of believing, from believing and declaring the good news of Jesus. See, not only do I believe what he says, I'm bold enough and aggressive enough and confident enough to not just believe it as an internal being, but I'm bold enough to believe it and declare it. I dare you right now to declare the best is yet to come. Right now to declare I'm more than a conqueror. I dare you to declare right now my best days are yet ahead. I dare you to declare right now my past can't stop me. I dare you to declare right now I shall be debt free. I shall be in my right mind. I shall be drug free. I shall be addiction free. I shall be happy. I shall have peace. I shall. Oh, I wish I had about 20 of you that were radical enough to start declaring, I shall. And you fill in your own blank. I shall.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
See, the problem Zechariah encountered is a problem many church folks encounter. He was listening to his current situation. I'm old, my wife. He was listening to his current situation. He was reading his current record more than he was reading his faith situation. So the angel of the Lord had to shut him up. See, God wanted to use Zechariah to birth John. He has something inside of him. I'm trying to contain myself, but God has placed something inside of you. And when you release what God placed inside of you, that being inside of you will bring greatness around you. That John was inside. Good God Almighty. Inside of Zechariah's seed. Zechariah's seed had to be implanted in Elizabeth. Regardless of circumstances and a situation. See, I'm telling you, you can't go by where you're at right now. When you sow a seed, your seed has future. Let me talk to the business people. Your seed has potential growth earning. Your seed has potential harvest. Your seed does not produce what it looks like, but your seed produces the supernatural. When you sow a seed, it's a little thing, normally a little brown ugly thing, but when you sow a brown seed, it produces something green. So God gave Zechariah a seed to sow it to Elizabeth. And Elizabeth was going to reap a harvest called John. And John had an assignment to be. God gave John the assignment to declare to the world, Jesus is the answer for every situation, every problem, every dilemma, every crisis, every generational curse, every spirit of bondage, every attack of the enemy. Jesus is the answer. John had an assignment to let the world know Jesus is on the way. You don't mind if I do this my way for a second. I compare John's assignment to that of a boxing announcer. I went to one of my spiritual sons' boxing match this week. Happy birthday, son. Before his birthday, he knocked his opponent out in the first round. Before the fight, the announcer would stand in the middle of the ring and make a public announcement about what was getting ready to happen. And I can imagine John was like the boxing announcer. In this corner, over here, wearing all red, we have Satan, the father of lies. We have Satan, the deceiver of the brethren. Over in this corner, we have Satan. And Satan is a thief and a robber and a stealer and a murderer. He has a long record of defeating and bullying those without faith. But over in this corner, we have, wearing all white, we have Jesus. We have Jesus the Christ, the Son of God, the Savior of the world, the light of the world. He comes into the fight with a long undefeated record. He's known for knocking out Satan and kicking his butt back to the pits of hell. In this corner, we have the undefeated, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. Now, after that kind of announcement, what kind of crazy man would choose Satan? Oh,
good with Jesus, but I'm confused why the church has left Jesus on the corner. Jesus still sitting on the bench in the corner waiting to get in the fight. Have you not heard? No weapon formed against me shall prosper. Have you not heard? This battle is not mine, but it's the Lord's. So why would I in my right mind leave Jesus sitting in the corner in a fixed fight? That's all I gotta do is say, Jesus, go get him. And I won't lose this battle. You've been losing too many fights because you've been trying to fight with your own power. You've been trying to fight with your own intellect. You've been leaning on your own understanding, leaving Jesus sitting in the corner. That don't make sense. If I'm going to get into a fight in 21st century, if I'm going to get into a fight in December of 2015, I got enough sense to know if I'm going to have to fight somebody right now, I'm going to stay in the corner and send hands of stone in the ring. I'm not going to go try to knock nobody out when I got the hands of stones in my corner. I'm a wise man. Why say hands of stone? Go get them. Well, why would I leave Jesus sitting in the corner while the devil kicking your butt with your finances? While the devil kicking your butt in your marriage? While the devil kicking your butt with your children? Why your children losing their mind and out of their mind? Joshua heard a story this week where a young man got in trouble at school. The young man was in the seventh grade, and they called him to the principal's office, and the seventh grade principal and the coach came to the office with his mother. His mother said, son, I'm ashamed of you. Didn't call me down at this school. The coach said the little boy in the seventh grade turned and looked at his mother, raised back his hand, and slapped his mother with the palm of his hand. What kind of world are we living in? But children are abusing their parents. When they asked the little boy, what's wrong with you? The little boy responded, well, mama keep bringing every Tom, Dick, and Harry in the house. And every time there's a problem, I've seen Tom hit my mama. I've seen Joe hit my mama. I've seen Bill hit my mama. So I thought that's how mama responded. When you got a problem, mama, I thought you just hit mama. Well, I could imagine mama left Jesus in the corner. Because if I would have hit my grandmother, I wouldn't be here right now. They would have been saying ashes to ashes, dust to dust. When my grandmother knew Jesus, I wish I had somebody this morning that's ready to tag Jesus out the corner. Get Jesus back in the fight. How long you gonna keep losing with Jesus in your corner? Watch this. Go to John 3:16. Go to John 3:16. For God so loved the world. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. And whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal everlasting life. Verse 17, for God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. See, Jesus came to save us, but we got to get Jesus off the bench. It makes no sense to be lost with a GPS system in your hand. Hit the button and say, navigate me. I dare somebody to hit the reset button right now and say, Jesus, navigate me. Jesus, save me. I'm tired of being lost. I'm tired of being frustrated. I'm tired of being mad. Jesus. Watch this. Notice. The Bible says Jesus did not come in the world to condemn the world, but to save the world. So if you're feeling the spirit of condemnation, that simply means you still got Jesus on the bench. Because I kept reading my Bible in the book of John. Because I got down to verse 4 of chapter 4 of John, and I see Jesus getting off the bench, and he tells a woman at the well all about her 5 ex-husbands and about the Negro she's living with right now. That ain't even your husband. But Jesus did not devalue the woman. He spoke life into the woman. I need Jesus to get off the bench. church to help me win in spite of my past failures. I wish I had somebody bold enough in here to declare I've made some mistakes in my life. I've made some bad choices. I've made some bad decisions. But I thank God Jesus got off the bench and came and spoke life into my dead situation. I wish I had somebody that was bold enough in your faith to holler me to pastor. Jesus stepped in and gave me back my value. Jesus stepped in and took the spirit of condemnation. Jesus stepped in and gave me a fresh start. Jesus stepped in and reset me and recharged me so I can reclaim and rejoice. Is there anybody here? So I kept reading my Bible as I rushed to a close, and I got to John chapter 5, and Jesus comes off the bench again and heals a man. Heals a man. Jada man was disabled for 38 years. Where my boy at? For 38 years, the man was disabled. Let me hear you right now. For 38 years, the man went to the pool of healing, but nobody would help him in. For 38 years, the man was disabled. For 38 years, the man was called handicapped. For 38 years, he was helpless. For 38 years, he was at somebody's mercy until Jesus got off the bench and Jesus got to the pool. And when Jesus got to the pool of Bethesda, he told the man, get up, get up, get up. And I'm telling my son right there, he was shook and now he's handicapped. He was shook and now he's disabled. But I'm declaring right now, Jesus getting off the bench and declaring, one day you gonna walk, one day you gonna catch a pass, one day you gonna run a one route, one day you gonna hit the baseball, one day you gonna put on some Nikes and run real fast. I wish I had somebody that realized that the man kept showing up, but nothing happened. There were other people at the pool, but they couldn't help him. But once Jesus got off the pitch and got to the pool, the man went from being disabled to being able. I wish I had somebody that can declare right now, I was down a long time, but Jesus. John, and Jesus comes out the bench again, because there was a woman caught in adultery in chapter 8. There was a woman caught in adultery. John chapter 8 talked about this woman and the church folks, the hypocrites, the holding and down, finger pointing folks was getting ready to stone her. But Jesus intercepted her death sentence and said, let thee without sin cast the first stone. I wish I had somebody that was transparent enough to say the devil had me on his hit list. The devil was trying to kill me. The devil was trying to take me out. The devil was trying to sabotage my future. The devil was trying to take me out. He tried his best. He threw his best shot. But Jesus jumped in, intercepted the devil's plans, and gave me new life. Is there anybody here and you got new life? Is there anybody here and the charges were reversed? Is there anybody here and you don't look like what you went through? Is there anybody here that's glad Jesus got off the bench and saved your life? I wish I had. John chapter 9. John chapter 9. If you have a Bible, turn real quick. I gotta show you this one on my way out of here. John chapter 9, verse 25. There was a boy that was born blind. There was a boy that spent all his early days. He went to nursery school blind. He went to grade school blind. He went to high school blind. But when he became a man, Jesus came off the bench and gave his boy his sight. And they start questioning him, who saved you? Who gave you your sight? And what I like about this, Ronnie, his parents said, don't ask us. He's a of age now. And look how this boy responds in John chapter 9, verse 25. I wish I had a church that would respond like this blind man. He says, whether he's a sinner or not, I don't know. I don't know a lot of theology. I don't even know a lot of Bible. I just started going to church. I just got baptized the other day. I just put down the weed the other day. I just stopped dragging myself to sleep the other day. I just stopped popping pills the other night. That's all I know is I was blind, but now I see. That's all I know. I was messed up, but now in my right mind, that's all I know. I was on my way to hell, sick and sin, all messed up, and Jesus stepped in, turned my life around. You know about Jesus, but I know he saved me, he changed me, he restored me, he renewed me, he gave me back my joy, gave me back my peace, gave me back my happiness. I don't know, but when I think about Jesus, keep him in the game because he changed the game for me. And as I leave you, I can't leave you, but I tell you about John 10 and 10. John 10 and 10. The thief comes to kill, steal, and destroy. But I got Jesus off the bench, and he says today, just keep me off the bench. Let me come in and give you life. And not just life, but life to the full. Stop being thirsty. Stop being hungry. Stop being dry. Stop being mad. Stop being depressed. Stop being broke. Stop being a complainer. Stop being a whiner. Stop being a loser. Stop being negative. Stop letting that spirit cruise over you. Won't you get Jesus off the bench? Because the Bible says he has come that you will get over you are homestead. You, I have come that you may have life and have life to the
today.
You have a choice. You can stay stuck, or you can put Jesus back in the game. Get him off the bench so you can win again. And you're never too old to start over. Never too young to begin. Never too far away to come back again. As they sing this final song, you have an opportunity to come right now and say, Jesus, I declare I believe.
It's what I do. It's what I do. It's what I do.